right, it's that time. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to today's Strategic Farming Let's Talk Crops program. We're happy you join us today for today's session on our biologicals and corn and soybean logical. So these sessions are brought to you by UM Extension and generous support from the Minnesota Soybean Research and Promotion Council and the Minnesota Corn Research and Promotion Council. I'm Liz Stahl, I'm Extension Educator in Crops out of the Worthington Regional Extension Office. I'll be moderating today. And our speakers today are Dr. Seth Naeve, he's our Extension Soybean Agronomist with U of M Extension, and then Dr. Dan Kaiser, he's our Extension Nutrient Management Specialist. So with that, so I'm going to turn it over to our speakers today, Seth Naeve and Dan Kaiser. So Seth, we'll start with you today.
Very good. Good morning, everyone. I'm sorry, I'm a little bit drowsy. I'm here in Ho Chi Minh City, Vietnam tonight. It's 10 p.m. Here, so I'm struggling to keep with you today. But and maybe after the show, I'll take you outside and I can show you a little bit of downtown Ho Chi Minh, Saigon. So anyway, but we are talking about biologicals today. And as a reference or as a point of discussion, I guess I should say, I think I'll start with some data that we collected as a group of soybean agronomists. I think it's a nice data set, and I think it starts, it's a good place to start some discussion about biologicals. And I'm not going to give a lot of opening preamble about biologicals. I think Dan and I can bounce some things back off of each other as we come back and have a discussion, and Dan may have some of these things as well. I'll just maybe make a few notes about them. A little bit for about our Science for Success group, really quickly. The soybean agronomists from all around the country have been getting together over the past few years and developing protocols for research studies to do collectively individually. We have common protocols that we put out, and then each state offers to put in a few locations of those annually. This particular study garnered a lot of interest. So we ended up getting 50 site years of data from this last year from all essentially an identical study. So what we did was—
Seth, yes. can you get that into presentation mode, by the way?
I'm sorry. Thank you.
Thanks, yep.
Yeah, that'll help a lot. So what we're looking at is a screen for commercial biologicals on the market today, and we've actually extended this on, and next year we're gonna we're taking this into a USDA project even funded on this particular study. So on the back of this particular work. Just a little tiny tidbit of some of the growth. I think everybody in the industry knows that this is big business. 10 or 15 years ago, I had someone from a very large yeast and inoculant company come to me asking about potential companies that I've worked with that their large international company could actually buy up, because every time they knock on doors, BASF or Bayer or other companies had been, Syngenta had been buying up all the little mom and pops. And so this was really big business even 10, 15 years ago. And now we're starting to see this come to fruition. The yellow bars there are actually the biological piece, but we're increasing, you know, from a $5 billion industry, and they're talking about in 24 to be, you know, $12, $13 billion. It's dwarfed a little bit by the seed industry in terms of biotechnology, but it's still, you know, the growth is really there. This is what the big companies are looking for. So why and how are these pitched? You know, these folks are claiming that they're improving end fixation, help assimilate phosphorus or from organic matter and inorganic sources. And Dan can talk about a couple of these things in depth. Increase nutrient efficiency and uptake, stimulate growth, and produce more efficient roots and expand root absorption through the soil. And of course, a lot of these originally were marketed for control of disease and nematodes. through a number of different things. There's in the old days, we looked at a lot of compounds that were, or a lot of biologicals that were there to really outcompete the microbes in the soil, the plant pathogenic microbes in the soil. And then later, some of these things that were meant to elicit an immune response in the plant and get things kind of jump-started there. So Dan and I have both looked at a lot of these individually over a long number of years, but this is the first time that I and in my project have really been able to take a look at this from a national perspective. So the objective for this particular one is to identify individual scenarios, situations where these biological seed treatments actually work for us. And that's the strength of having a large number of states and regions involved, is that there's an opportunity here to identify where they actually do work. And then to identify, to evaluate these things, especially from a plant uptake perspective and looking at through leaf tissue analysis and things like this. So I'm having trouble with my clicker. So what we're looking at here for this particular study is we put this out in 17 states and there was 50 total locations. These were all small plot replicated trials. These were randomized complete blocks with 6 to 8 replications at all the sites. And I'll mention this later as well, but we really gave this a good go. It wasn't that we were a bunch of negative, cynical agronomists that wanted to prove everybody wrong. We really tried to make these things work down to the last details, and including the statistics where we looked at these things at 6 to 8 reps per site, just because we wanted to make sure if there were differences that we could identify those statistically. These are the treatments. We had number 10 is actually the untreated control, but we had 9 treatments. These included a number of packages of multiple individual organisms all bundled together. And then including a couple of them that were just singles, like the trichoderma or the bradyrhizobia. And this is number 3, would be familiar to us as the oldest biological that we've used. This is the inoculant that we use to help soybeans fix nitrogen. So all the way from the old school ones, including combinations with bradyrhizobium, as well as other forms of bradyrhizobia, and then some other species. So I'm actually not going to provide the individual brand names for these. I think it's really a red herring, and I think that really for the point of the discussion today, we're really talking about the utility of these compounds. And unfortunately, a lot of us get a little bit sidetracked and brand conscious with these things, and so I'm avoiding that with the talk today. I'm actually going to go through all the data, and it's going to be really fast. So here's the first set of locations from Alabama through Illinois and Indiana into Iowa. We identify the control on the left, and each of these columns is treatments 1 through 9. You'll notice that a couple of the states didn't include treatments 5 and 6, but all the other treatments were included at all locations. The standard errors are listed in parentheses. The bushels are provided there in each of the columns. If there are no little letters and the lines are not highlighted, it means that there was no significant difference between these treatments. You can see a whole set of studies here where there was no significant difference. Kentucky, Louisiana, Michigan, into Minnesota. We had a site at St. Paul and then another one at our drainage site at Wells. Both ran in the 60s last year, not bad yields for the kind of conditions that we had, but we did not see any significant differences in Minnesota. Mississippi, North Carolina, into North Dakota, Ohio, on this particular slide, South Carolina, South Dakota, and then here we go, Renner, South Dakota. We had a location where we had significant differences. Interestingly enough, the control was significantly higher than some of the other treatments. So the control was actually in the highest yielding group. So that means that we just, although we had significant differences, it's not what we'd expect. And I can talk a little bit about that in a minute. Then we had three locations. Wisconsin, I think, had a total of 10 locations, and three of those locations had significant differences. The first two at the very top were ones where individual biologicals treated had the greatest yields. And incidentally, both of these ended up including treatment three, which was the Brady rhizobia. So this was probably the leader at those locations, even though those were rotated, there was probably some reason why they had some issues there. And they were actually got a response from the Brady rhizobia. And these were the only two locations in the whole country out of 50, two locations out of 50 that responded to the rhizobial inoculants. Excuse me. Eau Claire actually was similar to the South Dakota site where there was significant differences between treatments, but the control actually had the highest yield. I'm not going to go into any detail, but this just shows one-to-one figures that has the untreated control along the x-axis and then each of these treatments along the y. So there are nine different treatments. I know this is quite small. Basically, what you can look at is if these dots are below the line that they yielded, less than the untreated. Those above that one-to-one, kind of an orange-brown line there, are ones that yielded above it. And then this is, you know, confidence levels surround that. So, you know, basically these things laid right on the line, whether they were high-yielding sites or low-yielding sites. And you can see we had everything from 20 bushels all the way up to 100 bushel sites here. So, and along completely filled that whole range of yields. So real quick, here's my summary. You know, we had four of the 50 sites saw a significant yield effect. And again, two of them were actually yield reductions and two did include inoculants. So, I mean, I am really shocked that we got as little as we did out of this. I thought there would be more. I thought we'd find some sites that some of these things would work for us. But it was really disappointing in terms of the yield response. And honestly, I think it should be pretty sobering for all of us to see that we did see that kind of a response. And I would say that, you know, statistically or by definition, that we would actually expect to see 2.5 sites that had significant yield effects. So we talk about 95% confidence interval. That means that, you know, we're only 95% confident in these that locations that had a significant yield increase did in fact have that yield increase, and therefore we'd expect about 2.5 out of 50 sites to actually show some sort of a yield response, a statistical yield response, even if we didn't apply anything, just by random chance. And honestly, we had, you know, whether you look at two or four of those, we were right in that 2.5. So I will say, this is another note from the beginning, that we really tried to emulate what farmers do on their farm fields. And we really wanted to give these things the best chance that we could. We tested these on modern soybean genetics with current seed treatment portfolios, fungicide, insecticide, because we know that that's what farmers are going to be adding these to. You know, these products came from all reputable national and international companies. These were not mom and pop organizations. We didn't select any specific soil types or soil fertility levels for this particular trial. You know, the idea that these are marketed to producers that are going to put these on farms very broadly is what we were looking at for a background on this. If someone wants to look at very specific situations with very coarse textured soils or very low fertility soils, then, you know, I think that they should go ahead and do that. But we didn't feel that that's how these products were marketed to farmers, and that's not how we were going to test those in this round. And then we gave them the best chance that we could. We treated everything within 24 hours of planting, even though most of these products allowed a long term on the seed. We did this all, we got these planted all within, we treated these all within 24 hours of planting. And finally, I do really believe that there's a place for biologicals, and I do believe that there's a promising future for them. I don't think that they're marketed correctly. It's like everything in our business right now. These companies want to sell everything for every acre out there. But the reality is these things are, especially these type of products, are going to find locations and environments where they do work and where they don't work. And I think that's what we as academics really should be looking for, is identify where those locations are that we can suggest that farmers plant them. You know, I always think that that these companies would rather sell 10 farmers a product that makes 2 bushels than one farmer or one of those farmers something that makes 20 bushels an acre. It's unfortunate, but that's just the way marketing works. They want to get these things out as broadly as they can, and that's it, it really works pretty well on their side. But I'm not sure it best suits the farmer. And I do think that there's, you can imagine that there's really major issues with physical locations of these products. We put these things on the seed. Seed coats get in, ended up pushing out through the soil. We either get lots of rain that pulls these products down into the soil profile beyond the rooting zone and beyond the rhizosphere, the, those roots, or these products are left nearly on top of the soil or at the soil surface. Most of these products are not made to colonize the root and grow down the root. There's just there with the hopes that they're going to be around that soybean root as it extends into the soil profile, which seems unrealistic to me. And then there's the chemical problems that we have in the soil. You know, these things are designed to work under, you know, there. It's likely that these biologicals will work under very specific soil chemical parameters. And if we're in very high pH soils or very low pH soils or very wet or very dry soils, it's likely that these things aren't going to work as well as they would in other environments. So with that, I used more time than I wanted to with my presentations, but I'll hand it back over to Liz, and then she can pass it on to Dan, and we can have some conversation later.
Well, that's great, Seth. Thank you for that information. And yeah, hopefully that stirred some questions people have. So again, feel free to put those into the Q&A, and we'll address those after we hear from Dan as well here too. So Dan, we'll turn it over to you and see what you have to say from, you know, I'm assuming you're going to talk more on the corn end and then the nutrient management end here too, but curious to see what you have seen. And I don't hear you yet, Dan, so I don't know if you're muted or...
Yeah, I had to figure out where my unmute was. Oh, there sorry.
Okay.
So Seth covered a lot. I mean, just in that end, you know, some of the issues that I have too working with some of these products. I've been doing product testing since I've been here in Minnesota. And, you know, while, you know, we didn't have the real big biostimulant push early on, I mean, there were some products that we did work with that kind of fell along these lines. And, you know, really looking at biostimulants, what they are, it's kind of a broad category. You know, the general definition are substances or microbes provided in small quantities that promote plant growth. The thing about fertilizers are not pesticides. Soil conditioners were, you know, kind of the rage at one point in time. They don't fall in that category. And so there's been kind of somewhat of a gray area on some of the regulation side here in the U.S. Europe, I think, has a better, you know, set of regulation on some of these products than we do here. And that this is actually a presentation I put together a few years ago, and I don't know if much has moved forward since that point in time. There were some talks of providing some definitions with some of these products, but unless they fall in the category where there's some sort of fertilizer amendment or something like that, I don't think they have to be regulated. So there's, you know, you look at really these products ballooning quite a bit in the last few years. The products have been around for a while. They tend to go in spurts. You look, there's some data. I wanted to throw this out. This NCERA 103 committee, this was the where we had the compendium of non-traditional products. There is a change to the website. So if any of you have looked at that in the past, just be aware that the Iowa State website is still live. At some point, that's going to disappear. This is the new website. It's a little bit different front page than the Iowa State page, but it has some of the same things on there. The main thing, if you're going to go in and look at any of these products, you're going to want to know what the active ingredient is. And that's kind of the big thing, because trade names change over the years. You'll tend to see the active ingredients a lot of times. There's been stuff that's been tested out there. One of the examples when I first started was Jumpstart, which is Penicillium balai, which is a fungus that colonizes the roots that's supposed to help solubilize phosphorus. So if you go in, you can actually search Penicillium balai, and you can find some older data on that, even though it's not trademarked as Jumpstart. So again, I mean, you see these products, they come and go, and they tend to reinvent themselves over time, and you see them kind of make a splash for a while and then go out of the market. Okay, hold on a second. So right now, categories of biostimulants, humic substances, those are out there. The benefits of these products, we've looked at them sparingly. Humic acids are long-chain organic acids. Looking at some of the data, I'm not going to show anything here today, but more of the positive responses that I've heard of have been out west on potatoes grown in very low organic matter areas. One of the things about our soils, with the amount of organic matter we have humic and fulvic acid already in the soils. And what you're adding, can be just kind of, and that's with a lot of these, it's more of a drop in the bucket compared to what's actually there. Amino acids and other end compounds, chitosans, these are extracts made from, it's chitosan, which is what makes up the shells of shrimp. So we were using a product on sugar beets a couple of years ago, and it was like spreading a shrimp cocktail over the fields, what it smelled like. So seaweed extracts, the big category really right now is beneficial microorganisms. So bacteria and fungi, again, that Jumpstart product would fall along that line. So a lot of times with mycorrhizae too, if you're doing a treatment for mycorrhizae that can promote phosphorus and zinc uptake, that falls within the same category. And most of these, if you look, they're either kind of individually or in a cocktail. A lot of the beneficial bacteria, they can kind of be somewhat of a cocktail, but they're similar bacteria that do the same things. So free living bacteria and fungi, if you look at corn right now, the bulk of these products, they're going to be free living. So essentially they're going to have to colonize the soil. A lot of times they're trying to colonize it around the roots, where the roots are exuding some sort of organic acid that might serve as food for some of these bacteria or fungi. This is completely different than the Brady rhizobium, which are colonizing inside the plants. So that's one of the things that kind of the distinctions that I try to draw with these, particularly for dealing with some of these free living end fixers, is that they're supplying nitrogen to the soil and not directly to the plant. The plant still has to get up from the soil solution around the roots. Many of these are isolated from soil. That's one of the reasons we see a big explosion right now, because it's pretty easy with some of the genetic tools to isolate different forms of bacteria, see what's there, then try to package something that somebody found in the rhizosphere around the roots and sell it. There's questions and beyond that, whether or not any of this stuff survives and any of its benefit. And I'll show you some of the data, because a Pivot Bio's product falls kind of within that same realm, where they've isolated a product and tried to engineer it to work better than just some of the, if you just try to apply it alone. So another thing here, if you want to look, most are isolated from the rhizosphere. Again, there's a lot of products out there. The product we worked with, Accomplished LM, I believe, is kind of a manure tea, which is supposed to have a lot of microbes in it. We've worked with that. I'm not going to show any data with that. Again, that looking at that, very limited or to no response with product. So a lot of these products in the development stage, factors they have to consider, the plant species, because many of these are going to, what they're again looking at is certain plant species, isolating what's there and seeing what's there. And just, if it's something that's found near the corn root, it may not work for other species of plants. So that's one of the main things to kind of consider. Reproducibility across environments. I mean, I think it's one of our main challenges here in Minnesota with a lot of these products is the fact that we have some already biologically active soils that what you're putting in there is a drop in the water, and whether or not it's going to be able to outcompete with anything else that's actually there. And then the other thing is, you know, we have this thing called winter and cold soils that, you know, whether or not, you know, any of these products are going to do any better than anything else is another question. And then compatibility with fertilizer and pesticides. It's been one of the main questions that we've had, particularly with some of these biostimulants. If you put it in with starter fertilizer, you've got something with a high salt content plus a high ammonia content in many cases. You know, ammonia we generally use for cleaner just because it's very good at killing microorganisms. It's, you know, whether or not this stuff is going to survive. And that's really kind of the big thing on the application side is, as Seth said, I mean, when we test a lot of our products, we try to give them the best chance we can, but it's, you know, when we start looking at what we can do versus what some growers can do, it's, you know, vastly different. So we look at our data, we should be able to give them a better chance than some growers can, particularly with how we're mixing and controlling how some of these products are applying. So beneficial fungi, I talked about this, most are endophytes. What this means essentially is they're living on the outside of the roots. They might associate with the roots. That's where mycorrhizae come into play. You know, they will colonize around the roots. They help supply phosphorus and zinc and also help with water uptake. And what this does is extends the root system, which is important, particularly for phosphorus, since only a small amount of the soil is actually explored by the roots. When you look at it, and phosphorus doesn't move very far, that it's really important for the plant to be able to try to be able to get as bigger or as exploit as much of the soil volume as it can. Beneficial bacteria, again, are the big ones. Really right now that asymbiotic nitrogen fixing is the big thing. There's been some work on nutrient solubilization, especially phosphorus. That's always a big one, particularly for high pH soils. There's one of the things, questions I know came up with one of the articles we put out, and somebody, you know, mentioned that when we talked about phosphorus, whether or not these products are going to negate the need for commercial fertilizers. And the, you know, the problem with phosphorus is we know we have a finite amount in the soil. So, you know, while short term, you know, if we can get a product that would solubilize enough that, you know, maybe you could, you know, supply, but in the long run, it's probably not going to work. And it's one of the things with the phosphorus enhancers, they just, like any of these other ones, consistency just hasn't been there with that. Chelation also can help with uptake of some metals. But again, the big ones right here, this asymbiotic nitrogen fixation. So freevn fixers, Azospirillum, Azobacter, Clostridium. I mean, if you look at, you'll see a lot of these if the product actually lists what's actually in there. Azospirillum in general is found in close contact with the roots. If you look at some of the data, they've shown that it can supply 7 to 12% of nitrogen for the wheat. And if you look at a lot of these, we know that particularly for corn production, that the fertilizer we apply is producing roughly maybe 35 to 40% of that end yield. So the bulk of what we're seeing in terms of yield is being provided by the soil itself. And, you know, some of these nutrient cycling components with some of these free living end fixers are certainly supplying something. I kind of doubt whether or not we can get it to a point where they're supplying everything. And that's kind of the thing, even though that we're only supplying a small amount with the fertilizer, that getting these things to work, particularly if you look at a lot of these beneficial bacteria, that the activity tends to drop off with these bacteria if you start applying fertilizer, that it really is doubtful that we'll be able to get to a point at which we can completely eliminate fertilizer application, particularly for corn production. And that's one of the things that the proven products tried to do, is to try to engineer a product that can survive better and provide nitrogen in a higher nitrogen environment where fertilizer has been applied. Because again, if you look at a lot of these free living end fixers, the activity drops off pretty substantially once you start applying fertilizer. It's kind of similar to what you might see with soybean with nodulation. If there's a lot of nitrate there, that if they don't have to actually fix the nitrogen, they'll take up what's there first. So are they worth it? The field studies have been consistent. I'll show you some of the data here. Some of our work with proven, I've had six locations. We ended this work in 2021. I'm only showing one of five of the non-responsive sites because it's pretty consistent with what we see. So what we had actually in all these sites is eight nitrogen rates that we're applying based on BMP timing and sources for the individual sites. And if you looked at it, it's almost one for one in terms of yield with and without the product. So the blue and the white dots pretty much overlap each other. And if you look at the data, this actually is showing a 3 bushel per acre. You know, if you want to follow the trends higher without versus the width, most of the sites, I mean, it was almost yield for yield, the with and without the product. The only site that I did have a positive response was at Waseca. This was in 2020. This is a field area at the station that tends to respond to side dress fertilizer. It's an area that, if you look at it, we responded to close to 200 pounds of N. This is corn following soybean. So it's an area that tends to be more nitrogen starved. And if you look at the actual data, let's see if this pops up. The yield without the yield was higher with proven about a seven. This was showing roughly 157 to 166, so 9 bushel per acre increase. If you looked at it with and without the product, once we got to the limit or wherever nitrogen responded to, there was no benefit to the product. And the difference, if you looked at the what we modeled out with our curves here, was roughly 20 pounds different. We took 20 pounds less nitrogen to get the same maximum yield with proven versus without. But again, looking at this, this is one out of six sites. I could run this study 60 more times. Would I see this again? I mean, I talked to a lot of consultants and they're just a lot of inconsistency and a lot of no responses with this particular product. And some of the claims that the company has with, you know, 85% win rate, it kind of depends on what your definition of a win is, because I've seen a lot of information even out of the research side where they're showing increases in early plant nitrogen uptake, kind of similar to what we see with starter effects. But in the end here, this is really what I'm looking for. And this is about one of the only sites that I've actually seen where I can actually see that reduced N rate at the end of the season. So that's been the trouble with it. Looking at a lot of this is, you know, what's your definition of a win? What's your definition of effectiveness? And then how do you set these trials up to look at testing this? We have looked at some things in sugar beet. This is some data. This is with BioRed Biomator. This is high tide, which is a chitosan. The thing about this is looking at emergence. We typically see with spring urea as a decrease in emergence with beets. We've seen that it doesn't necessarily impact yield. With these two products, I'm seeing a slightly lower emergence. If you look at the yield data, though, it's pretty much the same. So there was really no effect with these products. So again, looking at this, this was a product, these two that were more marketed on the corn side. That's one of the things that, going back to one of my previous comments, is that, you know, some of these things may work for some crops, but they may not work well for others. So there tends to be a very wide marketing on these things to use them everywhere. But you know, there might be some very specific situations where these things work, but that's just really not how these things are marketed. So testing, you know, all plots is what we use. For nitrogen, I like using 8 rates, but, you know, realizing the fact that the bulk of you, if you're going to do this in the field, you're probably going to use, you know, 1 or 2 rates, and that's it. So I would just be careful in how you set these things up. Really looking at, with if I'm testing the Pivot Bio product, there's been a lot of emphasis on taking farmer rate versus the product with the farmer rate minus 30 pounds and then seeing if you get the same yield, which doesn't really prove the product works. I would actually throw a third strip in there that has that lowered rate without the product as well, just so you can kind of see whether or not, because a lot of this, a lot of the marketing or a lot of the thought here is that growers are probably going to be on the more aggressive nitrogen application side anyway. So that they could probably reduce by 30 pounds, use the product, get the same yield. The thing that you're really looking at there, though, is you just don't know, again, if you're on that aggressive side and you're just buying a product that you don't actually need. So the more replications, the better. Don't split fields. If you can, you know, right now there's, you know, with a lot of the control with auto steer, there's, I think, a lot of ways to look at doing this, particularly for on-farm testing. That's really what I've been pushing. If you're looking at that, make sure you set these things up right. I'm not going to talk about this. So that's what I've got. I mean, looking at some of what I have, like I said, I'm kind of with Seth. I mean, I'm looking at this, I'm skeptical on a lot of these products, just mainly that just because that's what I do for the testing side. I'm not against them, though. Really, the main thing with these things, though, I like, though, for being sold to the growers is that there's some demonstrated efficacy that the active ingredient, the way these products are work, do actually work. And that's kind of where I think a lot of times these things fail. There's a lot of trust in terms of the company, and I guess they can't put anything that's not true on the internet, I guess. So that's one of the things you have to kind of consider with this, is trying to find independent data can be kind of hard with this. And then kind of just looking at more closely how these products are being tested is really what I would suggest doing for most growers.
Right. All right. Well, thank you, Dan. And thank you too again, Seth. And like I said, we'll open it up for questions here. And I see we've got a couple questions that have popped up in the Q&A. So I'll just start up with the top here. One, it's asking about, does coating urea with humic acid act as an effective urease inhibitor as some co-ops claim? If you want to address that one, Dan.
So one of the things about the urease inhibitors, if there is some acidity formed, there can have some impact on the volatility. That's because when you look at that first conversion of the hydrolysis of urea over to ammonia, that if you have some acidity forming there, that's what acidity is hydrogens. So what you need essentially for the ammonium to be held in the soil is it converted to ammonia is to be held to ammonium. So that's kind of the thought process behind ammonium thiosulfate. What happens is some of the acidity formed in the band where that's applied can act as a urease inhibitor, but it's not going to be as good as a product like agritane. So that's one of the things about it. While it might give you just some, you know, minor temporary benefits, I still would look at an NBPT product if you're looking at a situation where the urea is going to be sitting around on top and the and it won't be incorporated. So again, I mean, the acidity could provide some effect. If there's some products out there, if you look at the actual mode of action, shouldn't work, but they do seem to have some benefit. And a lot of times you see where it seems like they're more of acidic products. I just wouldn't count on them to last as long. So that's kind of the main thing. So it's all about essentially, does it provide acidity where that's applied? And again, it's not going to give you the control you get with some of your other inhibitors.
Okay. All right. Thank you for that. And you do have another question here too. Got a couple more. Somebody's asking, what is the active ingredient in the Proven, or however you say that? If you want to address that.
I'd have to dig back into it. It's one of those free living bacteria. I don't know if it's azospirillum or if it's one of those.
Okay.
So it would be one of those free living end fixers. What they've done again is they've isolated it from the corn around the corn roots. And then they've tried to engineer it so it will provide nitrogen with a situation where you've already applied higher rates of N. So I said I'd have to look back at what exactly it is. I don't know off the top of my head, but it's one of those free living end fixers.
Okay. And then a question here. Could you expand on your comments for trials not to split fields and not to alternate strips?
The splitting fields is the main one that I would really avoid, because unless that field is completely even, I mean, what you're really risking there essentially is biasing your results if you've got your treated product in an area that's higher yielding that you, and really you need replication, because just having, when we talk about a lot of our testing wise, we have what's called degrees of freedom, which essentially is one minus the number of replications. So you can't just have a side-by-side and do an actual test on it. It just doesn't work that way. So usually what I like is about 3 to 4 replications. 4 is better, because we've ran into some issues even with 3 replications. They did some work testing boron on corn a few years back. And I had a few sites where it looked like we had a large response to boron. But if you started digging into that data just by chance and how we had, and we had it randomized and we didn't have it alternating yes, no, yes, no, yes, no, that when we looked at the data, essentially where my applied strips were, they just happened to be in areas that were higher yielding on that. If you look at, because what I did is I just mapped the spatial variation in the field. I looked at elevation and it all matched with the elevation map. So that's kind of the thing, is you just have to be careful that you're not biasing your results with it. I mean, you know, the whole replication and that statistical analysis beside, you just want to make sure you've got it set up so you have the best chance. And with the thing about what you can do with some pre-planning right now is if you've got auto steer, you can just turn your product on, skip a bunch of, figure out which passes you want to plant and skip those other passes, and then just come in and plant plant the rest at a later time. And so I think right now the technology is out there that we can set up better on farm trials than we have been able to in the past. And I think there's some really big advantages to what's out there, particularly with products with equipment like a dosatron. If you're testing these products that go in low rates that are blending with starter fertilizer, it's really easy to turn those things on and off when you need to and you want to do some testing. It just, as I said, split fields, it just the main risk there is that variability issue. And what you're going to likely see is a lot of variation with just with the overall yield potential in the field itself. And I don't know, Seth, if you got any comments on that or not.
Yeah, probably no comments. I think that sums it up good.
Well, I kind of wanted to ask you, Seth, too, about this, because I know you've done work with on-farm trials, and I could just see people wondering, you know, like with a lot of your work too, it's done in small plots, like, so I could see sometimes, because I've heard people ask this too, it's like, well, you know, your small plot research, it didn't work, but if I did more field scale or farm equipment or, you know, just kind of my field situation, you know, how is that small plot research really relating to what I see in my field? I don't know if you, I'm just kind of throwing, not trying to throw a curveball here, but I know you could address that too, if you don't mind.
Well, it's an easy one. It's an easy one based on the data set I just showed, because we had 50 sites. So, you know, the idea is that we, across 50 sites, we had just basically the whole range of everything possible that any farmer could ever have. Now, of course, that includes, you know, South Carolina and, you know, North Dakota, but, you know, which is outside the scope. But I think that's part of the question with this, you know, the challenge that, you know, producers give us about small plots is that we don't represent all of their whole fields. Well, that is partially true. And that's why we have to have multiple locations and multiple years and multiple environments to do that. And there are good and bad things about doing field scale research, for sure. There's definitely advantages to looking at things in a field scale, but you also have to appreciate that there's, you have to take the good and the bad with it, is that you do actually dilute out some of the yield effects when you have through low yielding areas and through hilltops. And there's a number of factors that we have when we do field scale things that actually reduce the overall treatment effects that we pick up. And so if you really wanted to pick apart, you could argue a lot of these points on both sides, small plots versus large, but there are some definite advantages to doing larger plots. It's just really a challenge for us. And I think ideally if we had 300 foot plots or 1,000 foot plots that we could actually do quite well, but you know, farmers don't really want us out there taking 20 acres of their field.
Well, yeah, that's true. Yeah. Oh, go ahead, Dan.
Yeah, I've got just some comments on that too. I mean, that's kind of the issue with a lot of the on-farm stuff, is we're really limited in the number of treatments. So kind of what Seth was showing is we had, what, 8-10 treatments. Talking about, like, with our proven research, we had 8 nitrogen rates with and without the product. It's really hard to do on a field scale. And So if you're really trying to test, and what we're trying to do with the proven products is try to see whether or not we need less nitrogen at the end of the season, whether or not it reduced the amount of N. I need more nitrogen rates. So, you know, I think for a grower, 3 strips would be ideal, but that's just mainly going to give you whether or not you think the product has a benefit. The issue with a lot of these, and the thing I didn't talk about, is that you can't overapply your N. So that's one of the things with these free living nitrogen fixers. If you're testing it, if you're already overapplying, since they're not likely going to give you a yield boost, if you're already kind of at or above your required nitrogen, you can't really, it's really hard to test them at that point. So you've got to really look at them at suboptimal rates, testing that, and you know, thinking where you think you need to be, then I guess dialing back by 30. But then again, like I said, putting in the with and without that treatment, because really to me it isn't a win if you can dial it it isn't really proven that it's necessarily a win if you can dial back by 30 pounds and put that product on to get the same yield, because you don't really know if that product worked and you still paid for that product. And looking at a lot of these too, a lot of them are marketed based on the price per pound of N, or at least a certain percentage, that it gets to be a pretty substantial cost on that, when you could have maybe just reduced your cost and put your input cost in, that you would have invested in that product in something else that may have had more consistent benefit. And that's one of the things when I look at fertilizer to me is more known. So I can predict, if I go to a given field, you give me the soil test, maybe the field conditions, I can probably predict what's going to happen with fertilizer, versus these products where it's anybody's guess once they're applied to soil what happens.
Well, and that really puts in a plug for the, fertility guidelines that we do have online. You know, you guys do tons of research on that. There's many years of research over many environments and locations, soil types, to develop the fertility guidelines that we do have. So that puts in a real plug. If people aren't familiar with that, go to our Extension Crops website and you can find those fertility guidelines. And we also do have some resources on understanding ag research too. People want to dive in a little bit more into that too, kind of what we've been talking about, the on-farm, that's really great to validate some work, but you can't isolate, a treatment, for example, kind of what Seth and Dan have been talking about too. There's so many other things that are going on in the field that it's really hard to actually see what was making that difference, in some of these situations too. But a lot of great comments here. Now I have some other questions. If producers implement other practices to improve soil health qualities, do you think they would need biologicals? Do you think that would make any difference?
I'll jump in real quick. I think that specific question leads me to think about using these products as inoculants into systems. Dan made a really, really, really important point that I had kind of forgotten about. And it's really a good one, is this idea that our soils are really highly biologically active already. And so we're dumping in a couple... we're dumping in six little bacteria when we've got billions in there, right? And they just get completely swamped in this system. So this question, really, we could go around and around on this thing too, because it brings up a lot of really good points. The idea, my personal gut feeling, knee-jerk reaction to it, is that if you're building these really dynamic systems that build soil health, so if that's no-till and cover crops and, manures and things like that, you've already got all this stuff going on already. And there's not really much you could probably add on top of it. But there's a possibility that one of these things might be lacking. And for the cost, maybe it's worth putting out there. If there's a yield response, then probably you got some support there. But, we don't really... None of these compounds are really sold, most of these compounds are not sold as products that would be free living and continue to live in the soil year after year, because it defeats the marketing purpose of them. We wouldn't really think about them as behaving over multiple years. They might or they might not. And most of these things have been actually isolated out of the soil. Pasturia is a good example. Clariva for SCN, it was a bacteria that was in a parasite for SCN. It was just pulled out of some soil in Illinois that was SCN suppressive, and they found that, yeah, it was taken out the SCN in that location. But it's probably around in a lot of soils already elsewhere as well. So there's a few sites that probably could have been helped by Clariva, but when we tested it, we just didn't find enough of those. So long answer, I'm sorry.
Nope. Good comments. And I'll just put in a quick comment here too. Again, anybody, as a bonus for those of you that are attending live today, if you do want CEUs for this, you do need to use the CCA app. There's a link to pull up the code, the QR code, and you can then get that code through the app. It has to go through the app, but just put in a plug there for that, because that is up in the chat right now. Here's some other questions. Looking ahead, are there any products you are looking at that show some promise doing as the company claims. So is there anything out there that has looked promising that you've looked at so far?
Well, the problem with the testing side is, you know, we'll start testing on some of these, and these companies, their kind of whims tend to change here and there. They go out with their own testing programs, and I don't always see everything that comes across too. So, I mean, right now I would say, you know, no. I mean, if, it depends who you talk to though. I mean, I know Paolo Pagliari is doing some work out of Lamberton looking at some inoculants that, evidently have shown some promise down in Brazil, but it's just like anything else. I mean, you, until you really get the physical data here that we really don't know. And that's one of the things too that bothers me a lot about these products too, is they kind of have their sales and their testing kind of go on at the same time with growers. So you're selling a product which you've got some claims where maybe in the greenhouse it worked, but then you're also trying to develop just some research background with that product as you're selling it. To me, it's kind of an issue there, because growers are paying for something that's really unproven at this point. And with proven itself, like I said, we've been a lot of research on it. I just, the bigger issue I have is on the marketing side, because when you look at these products, a lot of times there is some sort of scientific shred of evidence that these things should work. It just, once the marketing takes over for it, it just sometimes what you can see, you know, maybe it works at a certain concentration, but they figure growers won't spend that much, so then the concentration gets cut back. I mean, it just becomes a big marketing game, and that's really what you see, is just a lot of these growers, a lot of questions, just because there's a lot of products being marketed out there. And so the main thing is just see what research information is out there and try to scrutinize it a little bit more, because again, looking at it, the definition of a win is kind of the big thing I've got right now with a lot of these, because I'd like a little more evidence on these products are working versus what's being provided.
Good. And we do have a play in here from Zachary Larson saying, yeah, please make this data widely available. Appreciate seeing the results from similar work in Nebraska. But yeah, just don't want the data to sit on somebody's computer and not be accessible to the rest of the world. So that,
yeah, information, and I'll put a plug in too, Liz. We've got Dave Franz and the NCRA 103 group has been putting together some of the information that's been out within the North Central region for some of these end fixers. So hopefully we'll have those out, I mean, at some point this year for people. Look, but I know the draft is done, and I know he's working on trying to finalize it. So maybe it'll be out this spring. So I'll try to get that as a crop of news if that does come out, where that's located.
Great. Good to hear that. Okay, and here's a question. Do you also see the response to biologicals as a plant problem? In other words, do you think there is potential to breed or engineer plants to form better associations with biologicals and become more likely to exhibit a yield response?
This is an awesome question. I love this one. And I think that this is really where the future is engineering the plant to support these things. So the plants, the idea is that a plant roots exude a lot of sugars. The roots are pretty leaky, so there's a lot of sugars come out of roots. In theory, these biologicals could reproduce on those roots and actually form this association down with that root as it grows. You know, a few years ago, I talked to one of the people that worked at one of these biological companies about how they're screening products and if they're looking for that kind of colonization. And he admitted that they don't even look for that. So we're quite a ways away from that, but that is really the holy grail. That's the colonization part. And then the other part of this is that's very plant pathology-like, is more like Dan mentioned with Brady rhizobia, where you have the rhizobia actually have a complete association. There's a handshake, there's a recognition between the two. You know, the root hair, it basically envelops that little bacterium, you know, and so there's this whole very, very complicated, excuse me, relationship between the host and the plant, or the plant and this bacteria, that's exactly like what happens with parasitic or pathogenic microorganisms. And so if we can replicate some of those things that happen with the plant pathogenic microbes, then I think we actually could get somewhere. But I think that's, and there are a few people, I think Linda Kinkle might be working on that on campus.
Yeah, and Seth, it's not free for the plant either, too. I mean, there is some cost to the plant because it is providing something to the organism. So it's, especially with the Brady rhizobium, so it is costing the soybean plant something for that, too. So that's one of the things, I guess, to recognize, too, is that at times, you know, it may have some issue where if the plant has to help these symbiotic organisms that it may cost, I mean, you might see a little bit lower yield. I mean, who knows? I don't know. With that, because I said there is some impact there. It's not that they're getting everything for free.
All right. We have another question here in the Q&A. What about post-applied biologicals? Any information on that or anything you've been working with there?
So there was the one product, I can't remember which one it is, if it's Utricia or if it's the other product, that's a spray-down product. I mean, it's the same questions as the pre-applied stuff is that colonization, whether or not the stuff survives. And so it's the same thing either way. If you look at the data, I just haven't seen anything consistent. I mean, the only thing that I've had more widespread testing has been the Pivot Bio product as of late, but I know there's some other people that have done some work on them, and looking at the results, I've heard from a lot of them, it's either been no response or slightly lower yields. So that's kind of the thing with it, again, is consistency is not there to show positive yield benefits. So that's where I think what we'll see probably is, like any of these other products, they'll tend to cycle in and out as growers see if there's really no benefit. I mean, growers are pretty wise to that. Once they start seeing some of that data, you'll start to see some maybe leveling off of the product. That's what we saw with Jumpstart about 10, 15 years ago. Came in, a lot of interest, and then I don't hear a whole lot about it anymore. And some of that's because some of the bigger companies, they'll buy out some of these smaller companies, and you end up with some of the stuff just in the seed treatments anyway. So you are seeing some of these companies that already do have some biological products in the seed treatments. Some of these bigger companies, you're getting them anyway, and you just may not necessarily know it.
There is one other question I saw that popped up in the chat here. So the last 2 years, there's been a lot of residual nitrogen, you know, because we've had some dry years here. Is that why, do you think that's playing a role in why we have not seen much of a response in corn biologicals?
I mean, it certainly could be part of it. I mean, I think just what I said before is that survivability issue is one thing we don't know about. And we did do some root digs, and I've never seen any of that data to know whether or not the organisms actually survived that what we applied. I mean, I would assume it did at Waseca since we saw that difference, but that's the main thing. Yeah. I mean, you look at it, it's a complex system. When you look at the nitrogen cycle and you're trying to affect one thing, you know, you look at it in terms of that whole picture, it's such an interactive cycle. So that's kind of the question is, you know, trying to, you know, control one thing out of that cycle, how effective we're going to be, because again, looking at the, what you're putting in there, it's just a drop in the ocean compared to what biology is actually in the soil itself.
Yeah, well, we are almost out of time here. Any last parting thoughts you want to add here, Seth or Dan, before I close it out here?
I guess I'd just like to reemphasize the point that I probably came across as very, 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 very negative on this whole thing, but I really don't want to sound like that. I really want these things to work, and I'm really hopeful that we'll get something. And these companies know what's going on. They've invested billions collectively into this area, and so there must be something there. It's not all just you know, foo-foo dust. So I'm really hopeful that we can do it, because from an economic and an environmental standpoint, if these things can do something for some farmers, it's a good thing. You know, this is a lot better than putting these real active ingredients in the soil if we can get these things to do something. So I'm hopeful that something will work for some farmers.
And I agree with Seth. I mean, I think anything that we can do, looking at being more efficient with our fertilizer, I think there's some positives there. I said the marketing right now is kind of my main, where I have some problems with what's going on out there. And then just what needs to be provided in terms of proof is the other thing with it. So it'd be nice to be able to consistently work on some of these things over years. I mean, we tend to work with companies for a few years and then it kind of comes and goes, and it's really hard to maintain consistency. And with Pivot Bio too, there is a lot of issues with some of the researchers trying to get product this year, and some issues with the company wanting to control some of the data, what was coming out. And, you know, certainly that, you know, factors into a lot of this. So again, I'm kind of like Seth, I'm not against these products. It'd be nice to have some testing or a little more widespread testing before these things are being sold to farmers.
All right. Great information, you guys. Thank you. And especially thanks, Seth, because I know you're in a little different time zone than we are in right now. But I appreciate you guys joining us today and everybody who joined in today and in the future. And again, thanks to our sponsors, the Minnesota Soybean Research and Promotion Council and the Minnesota Corn Research and Promotion Council. And I hope you'll join us next week when we are talking about weed management in an era of increasing herbicide resistance. So thanks again, everyone, and have a great week.